pleasure for me to invite Professor Sharma from Sweden, from the University of Uppsala, to deliver the first talk titled Neuroprotective Effects of Cerebrolysin in Traumatic Brain Injuries. As you know, that being a specialist in neurorecovery and neuroplasticity, he was indeed able to manage the projection and face those challenges.
Thank you very much for this introduction, and I am very grateful and honored to be here among top scientists in clinical practice. What I will do is to provide you some information about basic science, and this we are doing to get together with the European Office of Aerospace Research and Development. This is U.S. Air Force Research Laboratory and National Center of Toxicological Research. And as you very well know, that Dr. Neuroprotection, we are collaborating very much. And this is also a collaboration between Global College of Neuroprotection and Neurodegeneration that was established 1 year before SSNM. And we are working on so many aspects together. So this is an honor. And I will share some of my experience with neuroprotection with reference to cerebrolysin. As we understand that in neuroprotection, the key mechanism is to protect the nerve cells and non-neural cells, that is glial cells and also the endothelial cells. So there must be some key factors in neuroprotection, especially where brain is concerned. And not only my research, but together there is a growing feeling that the blood-brain barrier is the key factor in neuroprotection, be it a stroke, be it any traumatic brain injuries or any other brain diseases. So we focus always our attention on blood-brain barrier in treating neurological diseases. Of course, we are working in experimental situation. There are many things in basic and clinics that we never achieve or compare. One of the examples are that in basic research, when we do a model, we have to anesthetize the animal, we have to put only one variable as injury, whereas in clinical cases, this is motor vehicle accident, this is done in conscious state, and multiple factors are playing a role. So we cannot claim that we are reproducing any clinical situation in animal model, whatever we are. But the major problem is also in clinical research. And this is so important that it is still not solved. How to get good quality controls? No healthy animal will, no healthy human will offer that he should be treated, he or she should be treated with drugs that are used to treat disease. So these are the problems in clinical cases. Nevertheless, both clinical science and basic science are surviving and trying to find good cause for the mankind. And as we believe that what we are going to achieve is the balance between neuroprotective and neurodestructive elements. There are no single factor in basic or clinical sciences that produce brain disease. So this is multiple factors. But there are certain key factors and denominators. They are active and that cause brain disease, and therefore, whenever we talk about neuroprotection, probably these things should be taken care of. So I cannot claim, or we cannot claim, that we have a model that is working excellent like clinical situation, because no one can produce, no laboratory can produce a virtual clinical model. But the model which we are working is quite close to those situations. When we talk about traumatic brain injuries, I mean, it is only the understanding. You can name anything like that. So traumatic brain injury, hemorrhagic brain injury, vascular brain injury, anoxic brain injury, infective brain injury. We should think a little bit more about injury. Injury doesn't mean something external to only harm, like traumatic injury, a skull fell or fractures. But these things also produce injury. And in that case, in some of the cases, even hypothermic brain injury is also much more severe than traumatic brain injury alone. And of course, I do not have time to discuss about head injury and brain injury, what are the differences, but most of you are much more aware or much more knowledgeable than me. But there are problems that after head injury, these serious problems can make personality disorder, and this is a very old saying. In general, I'm quoting this statistics from United States Health Services, but probably this is true for all over the world. The different types of injuries that can occur in the brain could be like this. This is one of the old cartoon in 1868, where this is penetrating injury. Actually, both experimental research and clinics have established that there could be different kinds of pathogenesis in traumatic brain injuries, whether it is penetrating brain injuries or it is closed head injury where there is no fracture to the skull. And the magnitude of injury is quite different. We believe, therefore, that the treatment should also be a bit different. This is another example from 1862, when normally brain injury occurs in the battlefield. This is producing much more injury than any other situations. So this is another cartoon drawn that this person has received a missile injury. This is the recent one. People are talking recently in Afghanistan. I'm not a politician and there is no politics, this is just science and facts. So one soldier has accidentally killed civilians. The problem is that why it was done? It appears that the person was heavily injured, he has head injury, and probably his personality is entirely different. So the message is that when we have head injury, even we recover, our personality can change. Therefore, this is very important to treat those situations very severely and very seriously. Also, you are more familiar to this brain. Just telling that there are different areas of the brain showing different areas of function. And we do not know after traumatic brain injury which part is injured, and depending on particular areas of the brain injured, the people will lose those kind of functions. This is very serious. This is also an example showing focal injury, polar injury, diffuse lateral injury, and secondary injury. Since most of you are experts here, I am not going in detail because I do not have time. This was one of the earliest reports about missile injury and how one can treat based on skull-based surgery. And this cartoon shows that after brain injury, many kind of situations will occur. Normal consciousness is here, vegetative states where this area is gone. Locked-in syndrome, even neurosurgeons and neurologists know much more. And here is brain stem. So these are very I tell you that open brain injury and closed head injury could be different, you know? And also the brain temperature and even anesthetics will affect the outcome. I will not show all of the factors here. So coming back to cerebrolysin, that we did experiments because this is a mixture of very good neurotrophic factors and many other things. So we are trying and comparing with other drugs. In different models with cerebrolysin, we have tested this and it works fine in experimental situation, both pre-treatment and post-application. So here we have a model that we developed. This is head injury and this is the force, 114.6 gram is dropped over 20 centimeter on the skull. This is the point, no skull is fractured, and then its concussive forces are produced on the skull that can radiate, probably also on the other side, so one of the model of counter coup mechanism. And this is an open injury model just to compare. The skull is open here and a longitudinal incision was made in the cortical level. In closed head injury, both the neurotransmitter metabolism and treatment are different. So this is one example of 5-hydroxytryptamine, serotonin, because this is increased very much after traumatic brain injury. You can see that this is left hemisphere that was not injured, and this is right hemisphere. You can see that swelling, edema is much more clear. When we try to treat with serotonin antibodies, of course, the left side was completely untreatable. Right side has some beneficial effect. So although the injury was put on right side, much more devastating changes are occurring on the left side. This is the model in rat in open injury. Here we have a lesion. After drug treatment, the lesion looks like this. And this is untreated. You can see that within 5 hours, these changes are much more severe than on the injured side. We always try to confirm our findings at light and electron microscopy. And regarding blood-brain barrier, here we can see that those with good treatment, we can see that blood-brain barrier is intact here. Edema and cell changes were much less. And compared to the TBI untreated, you can see that lanthanum is leaking here. And also, edematous swelling, probably pathogenic edema, and collapse of microvessels can be seen easily. I will show you some example in traumatic spinal cord injury in this context. Here again we have this model and we try to study cellular changes. This is the thesis was done on cerebrolysin and in a spinal cord injury. But here, since we are cooperating with US Air Force Research Laboratory and some other military organization, our interest is also to understand the role of engineered nanoparticles, whether they can influence the outcome of traumatic injuries to the CNS. Therefore, we use some of the nanoparticles treatment to see that in the presence of nanoparticles, whether the injury severity will be different or not. This is an example of leakage of albumin after a spinal cord injury. And you can see here that this is the situation of normal spinal cord injury where leakage of albumin is quite clear. This is with silver nanoparticles and this is copper nanoparticles. And here are alumina. So we can say that nanoparticle intoxication exacerbates neuronal injuries in the spinal cord. But it depends on the type of nanoparticles used. Now here, we have used cerebrolysin as a treatment given after spinal cord injury, 1 hour. And you can see that in different situations, in normal situations without nanoparticles, it was working. for the drug treatment can also influence when the injury is made in presence of memory. These are neural cell changes here after cerebrolysin treatment, but these are the different nanoparticles. The magnitude of cell injury is much more higher after the spinal cord injury when they receive nanoparticles. Here is the same situation in other example. You can see how they are much more neuronal damage after a spinal cord injury. Then we wanted to give the drug delivery using nanoparticles. This is the two types of the same coin. One way, the nanoparticles, per se, they are intoxicated, it can produce harm. But you know that nanodrug delivery can enhance the effect of the drugs. In this case, this is Dr. Ryan Tian from University of Arkansas, Bayfield, and this is Dr. Wong. He's a very good friend, and they are expert in nanowiring. The father of nanowire is Dr. Pudong Yang. He works in the University of Berkeley, California. And our Swedish Prime Minister is also very in favor for having this nanowire delivery or nano delivery to be studied in details. So, silica nanowire is used to have this stem cell delivery. These are early experimental stages. And recently we have concluded one volume, Recent Perspective on Neuroprotection and Nanoneurotoxicity. And as you can see that Nobel laureate Andrew Shelley wrote that the timing of the journal well made and given many discoveries made in nanotechnology and neuroscience, I am sure that this will be a great asset to the field of medicine. Another Nobel laureate from chemistry wrote the volume will definitely advance nanomedicine research for the benefit of mankind. And so, Dr. Ole Petter Ottersen, he is rector of the University of Oslo and also former chief editor of neuroscience, he wrote even more. The new volume addressing an emergent field that undoubtedly will have a significant impact on tomorrow's medicine. The issues discussed here are at the frontier of contemporary research. I think they are very good words given. And also Peter Riedler, who is the chief editor of Journal of Neurotransmission. And he believes that this allows both a fantastic view into the world of molecular chemistry and opening new research topics dealing with its nanophysiology and many other So this is the time that we must consider nanodrug delivery. And we have, in this field, since nanodrug delivery and nanowires are very expensive, I am very happy to have the support of former governor, Mr. Tucker, who is a Democrat. And here is these titanium nanowires we used with Dr. Ryan Tian. And also the current governor of Arkansas, my VB, has also supported this program. So we are doing pretty well. And this is an example in a spinal cord injury done by Preeti Menon. And here you can see that 5-hour spinal cord injury. This is with silver, and this is with cerebrolysin given normal conditions. But here this nanowire cerebrolysin is completely stopping here the astrocytic activation even after silver and copper treatment. So the point is that nanowire delivery of cerebrolysin even 2 hours after a spinal cord injury has produced much more better result than the cerebrolysin alone. And this is Aruna Hari Sharma, Nobel Prize winner in chemistry. He also feels that we are going in the right direction. Some of the tests that we have done. Here is the morphological analysis of spinal cord barrier weakened with lanthanum, and endomethacin has protected, so as cerebrolysin. Some of the examples. How much time I have? Sir?
Okay,
can I have 5 or 8 minutes? No? Okay, thank you. neuroprotective ability, we have used cerebrolysin and nanowired and studied evoked potential. And here you can see that normal spinal cord injury evoked potential came down the amplitude of the evoked potential across the electrode. And after cerebrolysin treatment, it is very near to the normal level. This is a remarkable result and undisputed. But the latency of the spinal cord evoked potential was not changed even after cerebrolysin. These experiments are acute, 5 hours. So you believe that at least up to 5 hours, the drug cannot block the latency increase. But the false expression was reduced by cerebrolysin. So as C-Jun expression, these C-Fos and C-Jun, they could be marker of cell injury or cell activation. So if they are reduced, it means that the reaction to the cells are lessened. And this is another example, cerebrolysin reduced edema here. This is untreated, this is cerebrolysin treated in two different areas, T1 and T12. Lengthening of extravasation, as I've shown you in different models, cerebrolysin is always protective even it is given after injury. This is cerebrolysin is given in higher dose and was able to reduce brain water content in T9 level. Myelin is very important component of the spinal cord, and you can see that normal injury can produce much more myelin vesiculation. Indomethacin did good protection, but cerebrolysin is it appears better than indomethacin here, even after. And in most of the experiments, or we are in close collaboration with Dr. Foon. I am very honored that he is here. We are doing some experiments together. And there are some other ways to understand how cerebrolysin can do this. And one of the area is that they reduce stress proteins, cellular stress. And this is an example that heat shock protein was reduced, not upregulated, by injury shown here. I will show you at the end these two tables to draw your attention on these aspects. Closed head injury, you can see these values, leakage of iodine, edema, and of course excessive blood flow, and number of neurons in geo. They are very high. Then the cerebrolysin was given 2 hours after. You can see that all these values were reduced. But when this nanowire cerebrolysin was given 2 hours after, the values were even better. And the nanowire cerebrolysin itself did not produce any change compared to the control. You just remember the values 3.4581 because you have to compare. But look, open brain injury, though the values are high, but as compared to the closed head injury, they are much less. But the results are quite similar. The cerebrolysin after 2 hours reduced these changes, and nanowire cerebrolysin further reduced these values after open brain injury. So my message is that a traumatic brain injury, we cannot fix that all brain injuries are one. Open type of injury could be different, closed type could be different, and I do not have time to show you that how anesthetics and temperature can influence these outcomes. So in conclusion, cerebrolysin is very effective in traumatic brain injuries, and nanotrack delivery of cerebrolysin, at least in experimental situation, is very promising. We have a lot of support from various organizations. the question, if I understood you correctly, the first question was that after how long time still we give cerebrolysin and can have good results?
Yes.
Yeah. My answer is that so far in a model of 5 hours survival, we have used 1 hour and 2 hours. And then there are different variations with normal or nanowired cerebrolysin. And according to Wai-Chien, who is one of the great leaders in spinal cord injury, he advocates that in spinal cord injury, any drug can be given until 3 hours after spinal cord injury. And in many other countries, for example in Sweden, if a person is injured, that is the incidents are very less anyway, the person can be admitted to special centers within 30 minutes to 45 minutes. So therefore, at the moment we are working, I do not claim that I work to cure the problem, but we are working to delay the cellular changes to certain times so that we can thwart some of the clinical manifestation. So in my experiments, we have given until 2 hours after spinal cord injury. Regarding your second question, you are asking, apart from other histological things, imaging can be used to study the beneficial changes. I am not a radiologist and not specialized in this area, but according to my very poor knowledge, I can understand, of course one can do that, but I do not have the capacity or even planning to do this, because being a neuropathologist, I always believe to see that cell changes are restored. And according to my knowledge, I do not understand that, or maybe I am wrong, but radiology in small animals like mice or rats can be so specific to differentiate between glial cells or neuronal cells or even endothelial cells. So therefore, we try to look at ultra-structural level, and then we try to see that whether these cells are less reactive. I do not show the other electron microscopic studies because of time. So, did I answer your questions correctly, or do you have any further questions?
In fact, you did, but the problem is that we know it's a good, you may say what you think about histology and electron microscopy, but still, clinically, we don't have this expected result. And the point is that also, there's difference between using cerebrolysin in cervical core region or dorsal region. Dorsal region, it seems no problem, but in cervical region, there is a problem, might be promising.
Can you repeat the question, please? I do not understand.
I'm sorry, but it's a new presentation.
Okay.
Next question.
Mobile telephone, it's a brain injury or